All right, I'm gonna get started here. My name is Bernard Dolecki. I'm the technician for the Institute for Electronic Arts. We're here for our event today. Before we begin, I would like to consciously and intentionally recognize, acknowledge, and honor that Alfred University sits on the traditional and ancestral lands of the Onondaga, or Great Hill people. With a proud and rich history, the Seneca Nation of Indians, also known as the Keeper of the Western Door, are the largest and westernmost of the six nations that constitute the Haudenosaunee Confederation of Nations, a democratic government that predates the United States Constitution. Today, I am here to introduce our current resident, artist in residence, Kamari Carter. Kamari is a New York-based artist primarily working with sound, video, installation, and performance. His practice circumvents materiality and familiarity through a variety of recording and amplification techniques to investigate notions such as space, systems of identity, oppression, control, and surveillance. Driven by the probative nature of perception and the concept of conversation and social science, he seeks to expand narrative structures through sonic stillness. Kamari's work has been exhibited at such venues as Automata Arts, MoMA, Mana Contemporary, RISD Museum, Flux Factory, Lenfest Center for the Arts, WaveHill, and has been featured in a range of major publications, including ArtNet, Precog Magazine, LevelGround, and WhiteWall. Kamari holds a BFA in Music Technology from California Institute of the Arts and an MFA in Sound Art from Columbia University. He is represented by Microscope Gallery in New York City, and he has been here with the IEA since March 18th through our residence, Artist in Residence program, which is supported by the National Endowment for the Arts, the Ralph C. Wilson Foundation, the New York State Council for the Arts, the Shine Joseph Endowment, and the School of Art and Design and the Department of Expanded Media at the New York State College of Ceramics. So without further ado, here's Kamari Carter.
Thanks. All right. Okay. Okay. I think, yeah. Thank you for that introduction, Bernard. Hi, everyone. Sorry. Is it on? It's not on. Maybe. I've got green on my little box here, so I'm hoping. Yes, no? I'll use the shore if it's not on, even though I don't. Yeah? Yes, yes, okay. Sounds good. Yeah, I'm a little of two minds with this right now. The first is I can absolutely just go through some of the things that I have prepared and treat this as kind of like a normal artist talk, but I can also totally ignore and disregard that, and we can just talk about like whatever it is that you guys may be struggling through, going through, thinking about as far as like art, your career, questions that you may have about the industry, things outside of academia, outside of the school. And I think maybe it might make the most sense that I split the difference. So maybe I'll go through a couple of these things and then I'll kind of skip around. We can get to the end and then we can just have some dialogue. I don't necessarily feel like this needs to be like super panopticonical and like very ontological. It can be very relaxed, which is kind of how I am. So so the first thing that I will do, I'll play this. This is a film that I worked on as a sound designer when I was an undergrad. And my assumption is that probably quite a few of you are in undergrad or maybe like the beginning of your graduate studies. And I feel like I like to start with this because where I was in my artistry and in my practice then is very different from now. And so if we end up getting to the culmination of the presentation, I think it's important to kind of show a range in the apotheosis of like what a practice can be, because I feel like lots of people that are in creative fields tend to feel a little stuck and are kind of afraid to like change and like transform things, and that should never be. So yeah, I'll just open with this film called Bye Baby by my friend Evan that I worked on a while ago now. Yeah, I guess that's it. That's the end of the film. It ends pretty abruptly. Yeah, so that was Bye Baby by Evan Barraza, who is a good colleague of mine, went on to work for Cartoon Network. Like Bernard mentioned, I studied at California Institute of the Arts. I got my BFA in music technology while I was there. And at this time, I didn't really call myself an artist. I was much more infatuated with just like audio engineering and sound design. So that's kind of why I like to start with this film, because I feel like there has been quite a bit of an evolution from then to now. And yeah, I just want to encourage people to feel comfortable in doing that. So who am I? Sound designer. I am an installation artist and a critical thinker. Other things that I am: I'm a pasta lover. I'm a donut connoisseur, I'm a moviegoer, and I'm a night owl. I imagine that the latter half of the list many of you probably relate with. So what are some of the themes of my work? What are some of the things that I'm thinking about? Life and death, morality, mortality, pretty consistent in what I'm thinking about. Disruption, necessary contrarianism. I've been teasing through this concept or this idea of like protest work or protest-oriented work, and thinking about how for certain bodies and for certain people just by virtue of having a practice and making the work is a form of protest. I'm thinking a lot about people like Vaginal Davis and Marsha P. Johnson, and even in a more contemporary sense, like Kara Walker and Arthur Jaffa. So these concepts are really important to me, and I'm still kind of teasing through whether or not just by the virtue of having this thing means that it's a protest practice, or if there are kind of themes that are in correlation with connective tissues between certain people's practices and how that coincides with protest. But I think about this kind of stuff all the time. Technology and materiality, like a familiarization of technology, kind of like dematerializing things, the back and forth of that I think about a lot. Real-time systems, really important to my practice, especially with kind of the stuff that I'm doing now. I'll get to a little bit more of that later. Blackness, not to be confused with anti-whiteness. Arthur Jaffa has a really good quote about this concept, and it's essentially just that he makes his audience, he makes his work for black audiences, but he has no mind and pays no mind if white audiences enjoy it too. And I think that that is important for certain people and certain practices to just make work for the people that they have the most homophily with, but just to also understand that certain people will consume it that are not those people, and that's okay. And surveillance. I think about surveillance a lot. I think we should all think about surveillance a lot, especially considering the advent of AI and how rampant it is. At any given point in time, AI is always going to be as bad as it is at that point in time. So it's always something to think about, because next 5 years, it's going to progress even more rapidly, and then next 5 years after that, it'll be even crazier. So I think about surveillance a lot. I think about how we're watched, who is watching, stuff like that. And lastly, emergencies, systems of emergency, what it means to be in an emergency, and narrative. I think it's important to make art that speaks to something and has a narrative. I think it's also important to make art for art's sake, and I think that there is a real purpose and market for that. I just happen to be a little bit less interested in that personally. So I guess we can move to an installation work of mine. This was done when I was a graduate student at Columbia University for my MFA. This was done in my first year while I was there. And I'm putting this in this part of the presentation because, and like I said, I'll probably skip over a couple of things, but towards the end, there's a kind of familiar retrograde of the themes that I'm thinking through in this installation that I believe continue to evolve. And I feel like this this kind of narrative, this never-ending story, this version of progress that can be like an autobiographical story or a story for me, but then also is mitigated into different spaces, institutions, and galleries is an important thing to kind of like think about. And yeah, I was in my studio in 2017. And like I mentioned, I'm from Los Angeles, California, studied at CalArts. I have quite a few friends and family that are in Las Vegas, Nevada, which is not that far from California. And I was in my studio in 2017 in New York City when the Las Vegas, Nevada shooting, mass shooting happened in 2017. And I found myself wanting to be close to the material that was happening in real time and far away from it at the same time. Namely because I have family members that work in Clark County as like officers, and like it felt interesting to be at a distance from this material, but then know people that were going to be very closely first responding to it. So in real time, I had like 4 or 5 tabs open on like every news media that was outputting information kind of at the same time. And then I started to stumble upon real-time systems of police and EMS broadcasts that could be kind of pinpointed at any area or location within the US. And I started listening to all the ones that were from Las Vegas, Nevada, but it was like multiple streams at once. And in the process of doing this, I felt like there were things that I was able to discern and make out, and there was a lot that was really obfuscated, not only for the sake of the information that was actually being told, but also like the quality of it. And I found that kind of fascinating because this was in 2017. We're in 2024 now, and the technology has not really advanced. And I think that's actually very purposeful, but that's also something to conceptualize. So in this process, I was thinking about kind of the experience that I was having in my studio, kind of listening in to these unidirectional conversations typically conversations that are intentionally obfuscated from the public. And that started making me think about what that would be like and look like and feel like as kind of an experience in settings where that's not normally the case. So from there, I started thinking about what an installation would look like from that. And so I kind of turned that into a project for my graduate studies while I was at Columbia. So this is some documentation of that. So that was at Fridman Gallery at their previous location in Soho in New York City. And again, admittedly, this was the year after my graduation from undergrad. So there was a lot that I didn't really know what to do or what I was doing or even how to do what I wanted to do because I was still kind of working through the comfortability of calling myself an artist. At that point, I was like, I play music, I'm a DJ, I'm a sound designer. The whole like art fluency canon was just not really my bag at that point in time. And so it's, again, interesting to kind of tease through some of these concepts because I was familiar with some of the material and I kind of knew what I wanted to do, but I learned a lot from that point until now for sure. But the audio that you heard that was kind of dubbed over the moving image were streams that I had recorded that were playing in real time at the point that this was exhibited. And again, like police scanner audio is not particular to me. This is something that you guys can find on your own. I think the thing that tends to be unique that I do is I pull it into certain like information data patches so that all of the streams can be mitigated from a multi-channel system in real time, but I encourage you to just take a peek at some of this information. It's very interesting. This is a work about home. It's a work about LA. LA has a lot of flat ground, and I used to skateboard a lot in my youth. It's a little similar to the previous thing, so we can skip over this for now. This was my culminating thesis for my master's. It's called Landline Lifeline. It was presented at the Wallish Art Gallery in New York City on 125th. And it was kind of a group show exhibition that happened and coincided with my thesis exhibition for Columbia University. In this, kind of similar to the other themes that I was thinking about with the previous installation, Rear Sight, I was thinking super specifically about 911. And I was thinking about like, oh, what would it be like to provide someone with a bit of a poisoned chalice on four separate things that seem as though they are not unique whatsoever. And then once someone interacts with them, they kind of have to piece together a narrative themselves. So I, and kind of taking this kind of Duchampian ready-made style to the effect of the sculptural element, I kind of decommissioned these old rotary telephones from like the 1950s. And then I hacked them all so that when you picked up the receiver, you got one end of a 911 call, but you were not aware of which end you would get. So you would pick up one phone and it would be the caller calling with the state of emergency, and then you would get the other call, which was the receiver on another phone. But you had to kind of piece that together going down the line, and there was no particular order that these were in. So you would pick up one line and it would be like, oh, I need help now, this person is doing this or something. And then you'd pick up another line and it would be a dispatcher from a totally separate situation. And you kind of have to piece it together as you went along. The thing that I found the most interesting about people's interaction with the piece was that they were more infatuated with seeing the sculptural element. Like kids would come to the phone and they were like, what is this? I've never seen this before. They would just like almost yank it off the wall. I had to be like, whoa, whoa. And then like people that were older than myself were like, oh my God, I have one of those in my basement. And they would like be infatuated with just kind of like turning the dial, which I found kind of interesting because one of the 911 calls has some kind of grim audio to it. And they, most people were relatively unfazed by that. They were more infatuated with just the fact that like they were seeing a kind of antediluvian telephone in a gallery setting, which again is interesting. Conceptually, I also found it interesting that there's a very famous artist that used sound named John Giorno, and he had an installation called Dial-A-Poem in the 1950s. And he kind of did the same thing, except he had people call in. It wasn't about 911 calls. He had people call in to the space to like have conversations. It was a lot more about like intimacy. And this was during a time where like Fluxus was pretty big and Yoko Ono was doing like crazy stuff and stuff like that. But there's really good documentation of John Giorno's Dial-A Poem at MoMA that was recently reinstalled, I want to say last summer. So if you're looking for anything that's somewhat similar, that would be a great piece to check out. But I actually didn't even know about Dial-A-Poem until I was like finished with this. Like it was brought up in my thesis review and I was like, what? So yeah, don't be discouraged if you think of a brilliant idea and then maybe somebody did it in the 40s, because that happens a lot. There is some audio that is a part of this, but I can skip over that because I've kind of explained it. So we'll just keep moving here. Let's see, what do we got? Yes, okay. So at the very beginning I mentioned materials and materiality. And this was kind of a material test that I was doing. The name of the piece is called Isolation. But essentially, I was thinking about splicing because, again, I have a background in audio. I do a lot of stuff with audio engineering, sound design. And I was thinking about kind of separating isolation, segregation, and also thinking about terminology that we use for these things, right? Like if we talk about, I don't know how many Swifties we have in here, but if we talk about from like the audio perspective, holding on to things that you have created from an audio perspective in the audio world is called masters, right? You have your masters. It wasn't that long ago that if you made two different types of tape, you had a master tape and a slave tape. And I think that obviously there has been progress in the nomenclature, but I think to think about ways in which we were thinking about this terminology or perhaps not thinking about it is again something to investigate. So when I was thinking about closing oneself off and then also splicing, I was thinking about what would that look like in physical space, with material that I was familiar with. And so I started using cassette tape. And so I would like glue cassette tape to certain parts of my studio and kind of have it intentionally cut off or obfuscate like access to certain things. And then I wanted to take that out of the studio and put it in a public space for a project that was happening at Columbia. So I started doing kind of this kind of thing. There is black tape that's usually the tape that's recorded on because it has the kind of acids that help that happen. And then here, there's white tape, and that's actually editing tape. And so that's the tape that you would put on the front ends if you were making an analog splice using tape. I also think that it's another thing conceptually to think about what it means that the editing tape is white tape and it's the tape that you would use for a correction. But you know, that could be way too ontological and heady to think about just like tape. It could also just be like you need a color separation to make sure that you know where the edits are. But I don't know, I'm kind of 50-50 on that. So yeah, the kind of evolution of this concept from thinking about it in physical space to thinking about it consolidated and in a more clandestine way was this. And so I ended up stumbling upon like a commercial that was filmed in like the 60s in Columbia University's archives. And if you don't know, as a sound designer, it's kind of my job to orient space in a sonic way so that there's consistency and familiarity for the viewer and the listener, right? So if you're in a bathroom and you're shaving, that's gonna sound very different than if you're shaving at a park. And the thing that I do in post-production is I add something called room tone, which is essentially like, what does the space look like and how can I ensure that there's a consistency between how someone would read that space with like whatever the stimuli of the moving image is on screen. And so I stumbled upon this like commercial that was filmed many moons ago, and I had a bunch of like analog tape stuff, and I found all of the room tone, which because it was a commercial, I think for American Airlines, it was like just very quiet. So I was like, this is all trash. And so I just started cutting up all of the analog splices that I found very interesting, and then putting those in frames. So yeah, this became kind of a different way to think about stillness and sound kind of at one point in time together, and polymerizing that in like a more wall-oriented way. So instead of it being kind of ejecting from the wall in a very like Fred Sandbeck, who's an installation artist I love, or Anita Thatcher, another installation artist I love, I thought about like, oh, it could be like a more like Ellsworth Kelly-esque, like just like very simple clean lines kind of thing. And yeah, I have some detail of both of those here. This reminds me of Barnett Newman, Adam and Eve, which is just like a very beautiful, simple painting of like red background, kind of a maroon background, and then like two simple lines. And yeah, I always have been interested in line geometry and kind of like the art historical canon that deals with that. But I also wanted to think about like, how can that be disruptive with sound, or can it? And so, yeah, this is another version of that previous. This is a detail shot of the other photo. And yeah, my very first solo exhibition happened in 2020. It was called Temporary Parallelism. And this is an install shot from it. It was in the basement of Mana Contemporary in New Jersey, a curator that kind of liked the stuff that I was doing at Columbia University, came to chat with me. We shared info, and after many, many long conversations, I was able to kind of do something. But it was also during the pandemic year, so it was a little strange. Didn't really get a chance to like meet people because we all had to social distance. But yeah, it felt like a nice culmination of ideas that I could consolidate in one space. So I have an installation there in the back. I have the wall work that I kind of just showed and some screen prints on the other wall. And yeah, again, just this kind of like, you know, the stuff from 2018 orienting themselves into works on the wall wasn't necessarily something I imagined, but I feel like in the context of kind of the growth of the way I was thinking about my practice, it was necessary. But it just kind of enveloped, it kind of just took place and took form in that way. So yeah, there's some detail-oriented stuff that I can talk about regarding the show, but that might be super boring. And this was also a video that was in the show that also could be kind of boring. So I'll skip over both of these. I'll skip over this too. It takes so long to explain. This is another solo exhibition. I want to get to stuff that's more, okay, I'll get to stuff that's more interesting, I promise. So I want to talk, because, yeah, we're maybe sort of running out of time. I don't know. We'll figure it out. This installation is called Event Horizon, and this was the most recent iteration of sound installations that I have been working on kind of throughout most of my career, I would say, that was shown at my like debut solo exhibition, that's what they say, in New York City. This was last year in April. And the name of the piece is called Event Horizon, which refers to two things. Like I said, I like movies a lot, and there's a great horror film from the 90s called Event Horizon. Please go watch it. And also, it refers to a astrological phenomenon where there is a sonic black hole in space. And I was thinking a lot about police violence at this point in time. And again, still thinking through these themes of surveillance, thinking through these themes of real-time systems. And so I had a 44-inch wall at the gallery to fill up however I chose. And I'd been working on this kind of installation stuff for a time. So I was like, well, what if I did kind of the previous iteration of the work that I did with Rear Sight, but I made it all about people of color? And so I took census data from all of the parts of the United States that had the most police violence at the hands of like the counties or the districts where the situations took place, and it was committed against people of color, and those were the streams that I was mitigating into the gallery, all in real time, all at the same time. So it was this like kind of loud and then also quiet, cacophonous situation, because again, due to the fact that the audio is real time, I have no control over what's being said or when it comes in. And I think like relinquishing that level of control is pretty necessary. I would say I'm relatively type A because I like things to go well. So it was a very interesting experience, but yeah, it was kind of the marquee installation. It was the first thing that you saw as soon as you walked in. And again, kind of similar to the landline piece with the phones, people's engagement with it was, even though the megaphones could be very, very loud, and Bernard can attest to this because we've done some testing while I've been here, they would keep putting their ears up to it. And like the gallery owner had to keep telling people like, hey, please don't do that because we can't control when the audio comes in, but they felt like it was an experience that they wanted to enjoy intimately, which was kind of interesting because again, I have no control over what comes in. So you could hear some very gruesome things, but people kept wanting to put their ear up to it. I don't know why. So here's a little bit of documentation on that. And this one's short, so I'll stay here. Yeah, so that was in my solo exhibition, Phantom Power, that again was the solo show from last year. It featured two sound installations and two videos. One of the videos was shown in temporary parallelism in 2020. And then there was another video that I made that was new. But again, kind of the big thing, the marquee thing was the sound installation Event Horizon. As you can see, also, the documentation got a lot better in like 5 years. So it takes time, which is OK. And I guess I will end with something that I also think is interesting. There's this piece, this moving image piece that I made called Original Programming. And I was thinking a lot about like television broadcast, television programming. And I don't know if you guys know of it, but there's a online archive called the Perlinger Archives that if you don't know of it or you have not used it and you're interested in moving image and just like looking through archives, I highly, highly recommend it. It's online. And it's kind of like a Wayback Machine, but for like TV. You can find stuff from like the 30s, the 40s, and the quality isn't always the best because obviously things are recorded in different definitions at any given point in time, but it's super cool. And so I was thinking a lot about Americana and the American flag. And so I just searched in the Perlinger Archives, American, because I was running through this question of who gets to be assumed American in America. This came after I experienced Faith Ringgold's Hate is a Sin from 2007, which is a screen print diptych. And on one side, it says hate is a sin inside of a Confederate flag. So where the canton of a flag is where the stars usually are. So in the canton of a Confederate flag, it says the words hate is a sin in a diagonal. And the piece was made in 2007 after a protest from the Whitney Museum, where Faith Ringgold and her friends in 1971 went to the Whitney at their 945 Madison Avenue location, which was previous to their Chelsea location now, and protested the fact that there were no black women in their biennial. And after that piece was made in 2007, it was purchased by the Whitney in 2014. And then it was exhibited in a show called An Incomplete History of Protest in 2017. So this kind of archival, but also autobiographical work about protest is protesting an institution and then is purchased by said institution and exhibited by said institution. This kind of cyclical nature of like collecting at the hand of a protest and then exhibiting felt like a very like sanctimonious pat on the back. And I was really digging through like what, it just made me feel a lot of things when I first saw it being exhibited. And so I was thinking about through like the lens of moving image at that point in time when I was focusing on making work for the solo exhibition, who gets to be assumed American and kind of what does that look like? How has that looked in moving image? And so I made this 6-minute film. And there's a lot of really interesting parts to it, but I'll just play like a small excerpt. And essentially it's supposed to be kind of like this this narrative about America, but it's kind of through the lens of like flipping through the channels. Because I felt like that work, Hate is a Sin by Faith Ringgold, kind of made it feel like the institution can kind of absorb anything and they would be fine with it. And everything is like super duper temporary, which again, I guess kind of speaks to my concept of temporary parallelism with my 2021 show. But I'll just play a small excerpt of Original Programming. And yeah.
Thank you. if you want to get yourself an aquarium,
don't leave my money for you,
a free trip after just 20
Oh, I dug my heels in deeper.
Working together to produce an ever greater abundance of material and spiritual values for all. That is the secret of American prosperity.
And yeah, I guess for my presentation, that's it. Thanks. Appreciate it.